right? So-and-so begot so-and-so. And I would reason to say that for most of you, that's not your favorite part of the text.
No, I forgot, and I can't remember.
Who's that? Who?
But I'm going to talk about, now that our secret codes are in, we're going to talk about how those begots are really, really exciting. Okay? Did everybody have a handout?
No, but we're getting there.
All right. They're still coming around. I'm going to go ahead and see if I can't get this display. We are going to be looking at last semester we studied the book of Exodus, right?
Yes.
And how does the book of Matthew fit into the book of Exodus? How do they relate to one another? Any thoughts? We got genealogy. There's a comparison. What else? What else are they alike? How is Exodus and Matthew alike?
A beginning.
Okay.
A beginning.
The beginning of a people, Exodus. The book of Matthew is the beginning of Jesus and the beginning of the church. All right, so as the handouts come around, Beth, I may have you turn this down or up if it's too crazy. But this is a little song about the begot, so listen closely. We all need to memorize this today. Pick up a little bit more.
Abraham had Isaac, he had Jacob, he had Judah and him. Then Perez and Zerah came from Judah's woman Tamar, and Perez he brought Hezron up and then came Aram and Amminadab, then Nashon, who was then the dad of Salmon, with Rahab, father Boaz. Ruth, she married Boaz, who had Obed, who had Jesse. Jesse, he had David, who we know as king.
I think that's all we got right now. But I think you get
that's
the point.
All we got.
It's kind of funny, right?
what
may have sounded beautiful to a people before us doesn't quite have the same poetic ring. And the last line of that, now listen very carefully, I don't want to sing this twice, is the last line. But it's something for us to think about. Is there any handouts left over? Because I forgot one for myself. All right, so tonight we're starting the Gospel of St. Matthew. And there's a reason why this is the first Gospel. You know how the Gospels go? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Bless the bed that I lie on. That's that old nursery rhyme. Matthew is first in the New Testament. Why do you think that might be? It's in the Bible. Yeah. I mean, it just happened to fall out first, right? I think that might be the real answer, Doc. That it's first because, well, something had to be first, right? There's maybe no reason for it to be. Okay, why else might it be first? Okay, well, it's a really good way to start, right, with the genealogy. Yeah, Luke's gospel also has a genealogy that's more thorough. But any other thoughts? Well, some people believe it was written first, so that'd be one thing. I tend to think, along with most biblical scholars, that the book of Mark is the first of the Gospels in history. But if you started the New Testament with Mark, well, Mark's Gospel is like half the size of Matthew. It misses a lot. So Matthew is a full picture, and so it's better to start with that. But why else? Okay, Steve.
He was very different from the other writers.
Yeah.
He gave it a unique flavor.
Yeah, for the unique flavor. And what his unique focus is on the church. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. Matthew's unique focus. So it's interesting that we don't have the name. So we have some manuscripts, papyri, and references, quotes from Matthew, but we don't have the book talked about as Matthew's book until the late 2nd century, so 100 years after we believe it to be written. So the book of Matthew doesn't start out saying, hey guys, this is called Matthew, and I'm Matthew. It just starts out. So the name itself isn't a part of the original text. It just kind of happened. And it's kind of interesting that Matthew is associated with it, because the apostle Matthew is only mentioned twice, and he is not a leading lady. He doesn't have a big role in this play. And so we don't have any real reason to believe that it's necessary that Matthew, because we don't have any testimony coming from his angle. But there has been some thought, well, maybe there's some other Matthews that wrote this text. But then maybe most likely the word Matthew means gift from God. Gift from God. So I think that if we think about it theologically, this book is a gift. This book is a gift from God to the church. And so the subtitle of our Matthew Bible study is St. Matthew's Gospel, the Church's Gift. When we look at about dating, this is getting boring maybe here, so we'll try to go over this stuff really fast, but we date it to around the 80s. We think St. Mark's Gospel was written just a little bit before 70 or a little bit after 70, right around the temple's destruction. And Matthew and Luke's Gospel, I generally like to say Matthew's Gospel is maybe the mid-80s, and Luke's Gospel slightly the late 80s, and John's Gospel somewhere in the middle of that period too. That's when the Gospels came together. So then the question is about, one of the leading questions we need to ask is, what kind of book is it? Right? So if we read a book of poetry and it says we hide under the shadow of God's wings, we definitely know that we're not to take that literally, right? That God is not a bird, right? It's a metaphor because it's a poem. So knowing what kind of genre we're reading tells us a lot about how to read it. And so then we look at, well, what is the genre? Classically, we've called this genre a gospel. That is what the church has called it, a gospel. Anybody know what the word gospel means?
Good news.
Good news. Yeah, so gospel is a word coming from older English, God spell, or which means good, spell, and spell is another way of saying news, or words that proclaim something, right? So gospel is good news, and the Greek word is euangelion, which is how we get the word evangelism. It's the same word. And so if you wrote a gospel, what are you called?
Evangelist.
An evangelist, right? So St. Matthew, we call him St. Matthew the Evangelist. That's his primary title. We don't usually call him St. Matthew the Apostle because we're not 100% sure they're the same people. So we call St. Matthew the Evangelist because he wrote the gospel. So when we look about the ancient world, we don't find other gospels during the early church period. You know, when you watch Discovery Channel, they tell you about all these other gospels that have been discovered. Mary Magdalene and St. Peter and the Gospel of Judas. And those are all, you know, very interesting reading, but they do not date to the first century, to the times of these gospels. And so so this genre of gospel was invented with these books, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. The gospel genre was created, and it was built on another genre called bios. And what does that sound like?
Biography.
Yeah, so the gospels are an ancient form of biography, where it tells a story about a person. And this person is Jesus. So now let's go into some background. Do we have any questions before we move on out of the nuts and bolts of dates and times and people? The question was, do people believe that these alternative gospels are real or just stories? And I would say that people generally use them maybe to discredit the other gospels while not actually believing in them, right? So the way that they are used is they say, well, you know, your four gospels, well, those are great, but have you read the one about Mary? You know, and no, that's really good. You know, and so they mainly use it to discredit, but yet they don't believe in these other gospels. And generally, people, as they advocate these kind of theories, talk about how these gospels are so wonderful. The Gospel of Mary Magdalene. Look, there's a woman who's leading things, and look, this is so modern and wonderful. But when you get to reading it, I think Mary's gospel, Mary Magdalene's gospel, is very unfriendly to women. That they were formed by male-only monastic communities who had very little access or very little appreciation for the role of women in the church, and so it really shows in those gospels. And so I think in many ways they are nowhere near as radical. That they are nowhere near as radical as these four gospels, which have a radical new way of looking at the world. In many ways, they prop up old forms of looking at the world that are less radical. How did that go? Any other questions about this background stuff before we move on? As we go forward, we might look a little bit about how, well, Mark's gospel is really short, and Matthew copies everything that Mark says. Almost. I mean, he doesn't leave out any important thing that Mark has. He doesn't leave out. So we know that when Matthew wrote his gospel, he had the gospel of Mark sitting around near him. Luke confesses to this, basically, in Luke chapter 1, where he says, you know, I've looked at a lot of different gospels, and I've looked at eyewitness testimony, and I'm writing you an orally account. And so we know that Matthew is doing something similar. But he says, you know, Mark's gospel's great, but we need a little more. We're at a point in church life where we need a little bit more help. And let's talk a little bit about the background then that Matthew's gospel is written. So we're in the first century, and the church is just getting started, right? The church is just started. Jesus was crucified, and they all went into hiding. Then there's a resurrection, Pentecost happens, and the church is sort of lost. At the same time, the temple is destroyed in 70 AD. The center of Jewish worship is gone, and the Romans are being really bad, and they're persecuting Jews. And at this point, that's interesting to us because virtually all Christians were Jews. So anytime we see something in any of the four Gospels that seems a little anti-Jewish, like the Gospel of John will say, and the Jews came and got him, we need to remember that both sides of this controversy are Jews. And so it's not saying bad things about Jews in general, but about a particular polemic inside a community. So Matthew's Gospel is the most Jewish of Gospels. In fact, in the old days, we used to say, well, maybe it was written in Hebrew first. I don't think that's the case. But it's so Jewish that we want it to have been. It is a very Jewish book. And it is Jewish in the fact that it is addressing a community. So the other Gospels, who was Luke's Gospel directed to? Any thoughts? We studied it like a long time ago. The whole wide world, right? The whole wide world, it goes straight to Rome. You know, that's Theophilus is in Rome, and I mean, it's for the world to see, and that's why when they get to the Christmas story, it's like, well, Quirinius was governor of Syria, and Tiberius was the Caesar, the emperor over the empire. So it has this worldwide focus, and it was directed towards Gentiles to convert them. And so how much does a Gentile know about Hebrew Scripture? Very little. So Luke rarely says, you know, he'll say, well, this fulfills something, but rarely does he do this, right? Matthew's gospel is not directed to the whole world first. It's directed to the church, to the community. And that changes the whole nature of the gospel. Who the gospel is designed to changes the way that we read it. Are you with me? We've talked a lot about reading somebody else's mail before. Reading somebody else's mail, you can make a mistake and think that it's for you. Right? Have you ever sent somebody a text message you didn't mean to? I think I told you a story about I once sent a financial secretary in Pensacola a message that was designed for my wife. Okay. And let's just say it was embarrassing for everybody. If the wrong message gets to the wrong person, then we'll understand it in the wrong way. And so this gospel is not meant to primarily to convert the unconverted out there. It's meant to convert the converted, the inside. It's to us who are inside the church, but we need to go deeper. And so it is Matthew's gospel in that regard is hardcore reading. I mean, have you ever read the Sermon on the Mount? You can't go very far without deciding that you can't, that you just got to step back, because it takes everything to the heart of the matter. And that's what makes it different than Luke's gospel, which is much more of a traditional gospel for the world. During the time that Matthew lived, the church was just getting started, and so it did not have it wasn't an institution yet. So the church was forming, and any movement, you know, Methodists started as a movement inside the church of England, and then eventually, in order to make the movement successful, they needed to set up a structure, an institution. And then that institution allowed the movement to spread, and then we now say, well, we got the institution, but we've lost the movement. Right? And that's a real problem. John Wesley was afraid that one day we would have the gospel but lose its power because of our institution, the institution only. But Matthew's gospel loves the institution. It's designed to set up the institution of church. And so it's the only gospel that uses the word church. That's one of the reasons why I call it the church's gospel or the church's gift. Three times it says the word ecclesia, which is how we get church from that word, ecclesia, meaning church. It's one of its main purposes is to set up rules for being a Christian. Christian ethics, what to do when we're suing each other, how to handle an argument between friends in the church. All of these things are addressed in Matthew and not in the other Gospels, because it's about how we live together in community. And the final thing in our background is the Moses Exodus typology. We've talked a lot about Exodus last semester, and because this gospel is written primarily to Jews, to convert Jews to a Christian version of their faith. So, like, when Paul was converted, he was a Jew before and a Jew after, but afterwards he was a Jew that believed in Jesus as the Messiah, right? So this gospel was directed to convert Jews into believing in Jesus Christ as Messiah. And in doing so, it's important that we understand, or that community understands, that Jesus is a liberator like Moses. And so in every single chapter, we've got references to Jesus being like Moses. So when Jesus gives the long sermon in Luke, where does he give it? It says, and he preached it on a level place. And what did he say? Blessed are the poor. Now when Jesus gives the same sermon, almost verbatim with a few changes of words, in Matthew's gospel, where does he give it? On a mount. We call it the Sermon on the Mount, right? Now, why would Matthew want to make sure that sermon happened on a mount? To be like Moses. And what Jesus tells in the Beatitude correlates to the Ten Commandments. It's all about the Ten Commandments. And so what Matthew is doing, and Luke, or if the sermon happened on the flat land, or it happened up in a hill, or it happened in a house, theologically, it happened at the top of a mountain. See how this goes? So Matthew's painting this broad picture, and we're going to get at that tonight, that Jesus carries on the story of Moses, and believing in Jesus is your liberation from sin, it's your liberation from death, and it's also your liberation from Rome. The people who think they're in charge of you, they are not in charge of you. Jesus is Lord. And so Moses is a prototype of the kind of liberation that Jesus would bring out of slavery into liberation. Any questions before we move on from there? We're doing good? Now we're going to dive in. If you got your Bibles, or actually I have that TV turned on so we would use our Bible here. Maybe I'll do it again. We're going to start in verse 1, and verse 1 is really simple. The NRSV says, an account of the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, and then the son of Abraham. What's remarkable here is the Greek here does not say an account of the genealogy. It says biblios, which, what does that sound like? Bibliography, it means book. And then the Greek there is, you might recognize it too, genesios. So biblios, genesios. Okay, what does that sound like? Genesis, right? So now, the book of Matthew, one of the reasons why it's first is it starts with this word, the book of Genesis. This is the book of Genesis of Jesus Christ. And so we get the same word, genealogy, comes from the word Genesis. So Matthew starts its gospel with the beginning. This is the Genesis of Jesus Christ. And then it tells us he's the Messiah. Messiah, that is a political term. Christ is the one that kicks out the bad guys. That's what Christ means. The Messiah is the one that would come and take out the foreign occupiers and liberate people. So Christ is a liberating term. Isn't that interesting when we say the word Christ? We're calling Jesus a liberator. One who rules politically. Son of David. That's also a political term. How is it a political term?
King.
David was the great king, right? And so Jesus being a son of David means that he has a stake, a claim to that throne. So, let's try this again. It did quit on me earlier, though, didn't it? Because not everybody has. Next week, if you want to bring your Bibles, that would be great to do, too, because maybe your translation's a little bit different. So, now we get into the Begats. He was the son of Abraham. Now, Luke's gospel, where does it start? It starts with Adam. It goes in reverse. It ends with Adam. It starts with Jesus, moves its way, and then it says that he was the son of Adam, and then Adam was the son of God. And so what Luke is telling us about Jesus and that genealogy is who Jesus is. Jesus is the son of God. That's the whole reason why. These genealogies, most of the time, we don't like them, right? I bet if you did any pre-reading, you skipped over all these, right? If you did any pre-reading, you did not read. I bet you there's nobody here that read the genealogy for real. You tried. Okay. Well, yeah, we try, but it's hard. It's tough sledding to read all these names, right? But these genealogies are amazing. Okay, so Luke's genealogy is amazing because it tells us that Jesus is the Son of God. So it's very theological. This one is even crazier. This one's even crazier. And it's got all kinds of great golden things in it for us to discover. So it starts with Abraham. Why Abraham? Huh?
All right.
Yeah, Abraham's story really starts out the whole covenant. Right, so now we're talking about a Jewish book about a family of faith, and we start with covenant. We start with covenant. We don't need to go to creation. This is the church's book. We start with the covenant, and we move from there. Abraham, the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. And Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Whoa! What happened now? Huh? Well, yeah. Well, the most jarring thing is we just got a what?
A woman.
A woman. Now, if you know anything about ancient genealogies, is that, well, you didn't list the women, right? Women aren't all that important, right, in the ancient Near East. They forgot how important they were, right? Women have always been important. We wouldn't be here without them. But these cultures were extremely patriarchal, and so to find a woman here in the beginning, this is amazing. Now you're wondering, what's going on here? What's happened here? And then let's skip down a little bit. We're going to come back to Tamar. Did I miss somebody already? No. Verse 5. Solomon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab. Well, what in the world is Rahab doing in this list? Okay, let's go down to 7. And Solomon, let's go to 6. Jesse, the father of King David. And David was the father of Solomon. And Solomon, the wife of Uriah. What do we got now? Bathsheba. Yeah, but he didn't want to say her name. You know, it's embarrassing. You can't say Bathsheba. It's just the wife of Uriah. Yeah. Yeah, but here we've done it again. All right, let's go a little further. And Ruth. Ruth is in 5. Thank you. And 5. Yeah, I left out Ruth here. And Solomon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed, by Ruth. All right, and then the last one, of course, is
Mary.
The Blessed Virgin herself, Mary. Yeah, so we have not one, not two, but 5 women in this genealogy. And what is this about, huh, Bernadette?
Well, I know that in order for somebody to be called Jewish, the mother has to be Jewish.
Yeah, when did that change?
That changed during the Roman occupation, and any time that people are persecuted, their society shifts from patriarchal to matriarchal, because that's its strongest point. And so anytime, the Romans would come in and they would be raping, and you wouldn't be able to know. You know, the Romans were trying to Romanize people as well. And so they, in order to pivot back to the most concrete form of community, they decided women. And it happened at the Roman during the Roman occupation. But it happens in every culture when there's extreme persecution, and the culture is shaken. We see that also in slavery in America. That similar kind of shift towards matriarchal. Society. So these women. What else do these women have in common? Well, let's say minus Mary. The other 4. Huh? Promiscuity. Yeah. Well, let's put a note on that, because I gotta come back to that. I'm not sure exactly how to talk about these things. But they have, all of these women have interesting sexual histories. Okay? But there's another thing they have in common before we talk about sexuality, and we all turn our faces red. The women are all Gentiles. Okay, so now we have a Jewish book directed towards Jewish people with a bunch of women who are Gentiles. Isn't this marvelous? I mean, this is telling us something about where this gospel is going. Okay, this gospel is telling the community that there's a lot of people that we're leaving out. This community, one of its problems is that it's too insular, and we've got to add some people. And so that's going to be a major message here. And these people are Gentile people. And that, look at here, we've been adding Gentile people all the way down the line. You know what makes us really good Jews? Is we welcome Gentiles into our family. That's what Matthew said. You want to be a good Jewish Christian? Look at these Gentiles that come into the family of our Lord. Isn't that amazing? And they're women too. And they're women too. Now, why would he be interested in telling us stories about these interesting sexual lives? Well, okay, Tamar, you remember she seduced her father-in-law after her husband's died away? She pretended she was a prostitute, because he wouldn't take her in. It was the family's job to give her a husband, and they didn't do the job. And so she said, you know what? I'm gonna take my future into my own hands, and she tricked the patriarch. And this, I love these stories of that. You've got a weak woman without any status in society who comes in and tricks the guy at the very top, and is tied into the family. What a wonderful story that is, huh? What a wonderful story. You got to go and read that. I think it's Genesis 28. And then what about Rahab? What's her story? She's
smuggled the spies into
Yeah, into Jericho, into the wall, and lowered him down. That's one of my favorite stories. Yeah, and she's a prostitute. And the prostitute saves all the people. She saves them, and then she gets married into the family. Isn't that wonderful, too? What a wonderful story. This is our family story right here.
My Fair Lady.
My Fair Lady.
Biblical version.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not sure if we got your genealogy out, we could find some skeletons in your closet. Huh? Yeah, you don't want to talk about it. You know it. Okay, so then who's next? Ruth! What about Ruth's story? Oh, I just love these stories. Ruth's stories. Remember what happened? On the threshing floor. On the threshing floor. You remember the story? It's like better than HBO. I mean, she was a Gentile, you remember? And her husband died, and then she went back with her mother-in-law, and then she didn't have a people. And then the mother-in-law was like, well, we're going to solve this problem. You're going to glean in Boaz's field. And then, well, he's drunk and asleep. We're going to, like, come right in there and warm up his feet. These are all terrible euphemisms, okay? And then something happens on the threshing floor, and there's a baby born. And so she just worked her way into the patriarch. I mean, she's come from the bottom of society, from the people that the Jews were trying to kill just across the Jordan. And now all of a sudden, she is married to the patriarch and is in charge of the family. Isn't this a wonderful story? That's David's great-grandmother. Or I might have an extra great in there. She's David's grandmother. And she is a tricky lady who like Tamara, takes her fate into her own hands, right? And so we have a powerful woman who uses all that she has and changes the story of Israel's history. What about Bathsheba? We know that story, right? Yeah, she changes the course of Israel's history, and her son, of course, is Solomon. And he's another example of a very powerful lady. Now, what does Mary have in common with these four women? What does Saint Mary, the Blessed Virgin with the blue cloth over her head and the Christmas cards, always so beautiful and fair skin?
She was just picked.
What does she have in common with these people?
Unwed mother.
She's an unwed mother, so she's got a PR problem. Right?
She's got
a PR problem because she's got the baby before the marriage, and guess what? It ain't Joseph's son. So she's got a problem. Huh? What else? So we said that she was a handmaiden. She was in poverty on the edges of society, young and poor, and a baby that wasn't the father's. And you can see what there's a lot in common here. What else does she have in common?
Poor.
Okay, poor. I think the biggest thing is she's running the show. I mean, this little girl from Nazareth with the baby who's poor, she's in charge. I mean, she has got it. She is overthrowing the whole church. She's taken over, just like Tamara flipped Judah, the patriarch. Mary is flipping the whole synagogue, the whole Jewish structure with her story, and pushing it into a radical new direction. Now, wasn't this a great genealogy? Huh? This was a great... Huh?
You added a lot of spice to it.
Well, added a lot of spice. Well, there's plenty of spice to this genealogy. It's all right there. I mean, it's like a who's who of the HBO stories in the Bible, right here in this genealogy. So what do you think that including patriarchs, kings, and prostitutes says about who Jesus is?
He's a man for everybody.
He's a man for everybody. Like, we can all see ourselves in there in some way. He's a man for everybody. What else do you think it says about who Jesus is? To be a part of my family. Right? I mean, this man.
He is
like,
part of
yeah, yeah. it's like this could be our family tree, you know? I'm sure you've got wonderful stories about in fact, if we had more time, I'd have you break into groups and talk about how genealogy has informed your life. If you look at your people, the story goes about the Lentzes when they became Methodist. They were Catholic from Germany, and they didn't go to church enough, especially Ambrose, my great-grandfather. He was a farmer, and he did not go to church, and he missed Easter Sunday, and he died. And the Catholic cemetery said, you cannot be married in this Catholic you cannot be buried in this Catholic cemetery. And you know, there was no public cemetery in that town. The only other cemetery was the Methodist one. So at that moment, this is our story. At that moment, the Lentzes decided it was going to be the Methodist church that they didn't go to. That's how they converted to Methodist. The rest is history.
Except for Mary.
I'm sure you've got some wonderful stories too from your own family that are colorful. And boy, Liz's family's just really interesting. They were the first into Florida, you know. They were original crackers when it was British territory, and boy, she's got relatives that were hung down at Cedar Key and back in the Wild West days. And her family loves to tell those stories because it says something about them, you know, that they were here in Florida forever, and that it belongs to them in some way, and that. It makes a lot of craziness make sense, right? And so I think maybe some of the craziness in Jesus' family makes sense when you talk about these women, right, who have completely changed the narrative. And Mary is the number one figure. So let's move on a little bit to the Christmas story. We got good at this a few weeks ago. Verse 18 starts the Christmas story. And it's interesting that we just got to Mary, but then in Jewish tradition, the story is mostly about Joseph again. So it's not fully there as we might expect it to be. But so we've got the story about Joseph and how he becomes a stepfather. He gets the dream. He gets the message that says to name. To name him Jesus, and Joseph is tricked in the same similar way that Judah might have been, or Boaz, and this story is now happening to him, but at the same time he allows it to happen, and so Joseph sort of stands in for this gospel for the rest of us. He is the one that this gospel is happening to, and now he has to figure out what to do with it. And I think that since we have moved here to a town named for St. Joe, right, that I've just given the St. Joe a lot of thought. That, you know, we don't really honor him enough. I think, well, Catholics do a pretty good job talking about Mary. Protestants don't really talk about her very much because we're afraid people might think we're Catholic. But we ought to. We ought to talk about Mary a lot because she's the center of this story, right? She's the prototype for all the Christians. And so so I think we are right to admire her. Of course, not even Catholics believe that she should be worshipped. That's adoration. That's very different than because... Well, they're our mother, so you always want to respect your father and mother, right? The Ten Commandments. And so we need to be very respectful of the Catholic Church, because if it weren't for them, we wouldn't be here. and so I try also to think good things about them as much as I can. But this doctrine of the Immaculate Conception in particular and the perfection of Mary comes from, was made a crucial doctrine to believe in, a dogma, in the early 1800s. And so it's something that Protestants are very angry about it because they have enough things that we're trying to agree with them on, and then they come up with new things that we have to agree with them on. And so so it is kind of a sticky subject. But I think that the biggest part about Mary is that the angel Gabriel says she's full of grace. And so I think that as Methodist, we believe in this doctrine of Christian perfection, which means that one person could be perfect, and we could be perfect only by grace, and we also kind of believe that maybe everybody ought to be able to do it, but we've never really met anybody that was. Right? But I think we could say, well, Mary is as close to the Methodist teaching of perfection as we could get, but she didn't get there because there was something special about her. And I think that's where we want to be really careful. There's nothing special about Mary. In fact, Mary is chosen, it seems to me, because she's the least special person. And that's what makes her special, because she's not special. And it was her that was chosen. And that choosing filled her up with grace. And that grace leads to perfection. And so I think that's the best way to talk about it. That because we can get to thinking that there's something special about her that makes her a co-redemptrix, makes her a part of the plan where she's an actor. And I think that, theologically speaking, God is the only actor, and everything is a response to her. Yes?
I feel like the one thing that we don't know that much about Mary is what was inside her own heart, other than what she says in the Magnificat. But I kind of think of her like David.
Yeah.
We don't know. I mean, she really had a lot inside her that God knew about.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, another reason why we've tried to make her completely sinless is, well, we believe that Jesus was sinless, and then, well, if there's a little bit of Mary inside of Jesus, like, well, if we're trying to do divine DNA, which I think this is a really bad idea, like trying to map Jesus's genome, it's probably not worth doing, right? It's just, but we constantly have people trying to think through this, but they say, well, you know, He's part her, and he's sinless, and so we got to make sure that there's no sin coming from that side of the DNA, and so she's got to be perfect too, and then she was born. The Immaculate Conception is her birth, so you can see. But I think that what we missed there is that Jesus was susceptible to temptation. Jesus was tempted. I mean, that's just a crucial part of the story. He had the ability to sin if he wanted to. And so I think that he gets that from Mary's side of the family. Oh, yeah. Well, you can't blame it on Jesus' father. I mean, he's the Lord. So, yeah.
So you said that this kind of movement came about in the early 1800s.
That's when it was locked in into a church dogma. The Pope issued an ex cathedra, and then it became a nightmare for ecumenical conversation.
So was that kind of going on? Was that kind of like a, for lack of a better word, a Victorianization of Christianity at that time, where, you know, the Victorian movement of just how those people fought and how you couldn't have legs on furniture that looked like women's legs and, you know, all that kind of stuff. Was that kind of just kind of a worldwide movement at that time?
You're actually right. Yeah. And there's just a greater interest in sexuality. There's such irony in Victorian views about sex, but you're right. It also was able, it was meant to be aggressive to the growing Protestant church in America. Mm-hmm. And so it had some punch to it, and that doctrine did cause some ecumenical damage. Because we're trying to be, you know, Jesus wants one church. So, you know, the Methodists have bishops that go over, and we want the Pope to say, hey, y'all are Christians too, and we want to be able to say to the Pope, y'all are Christians too, and we ought to be accountable to one another. That doesn't necessarily mean that we all have to be under the Pope, but the Pope, if we're going to be Christians, the Pope's got to be accountable to us, and we've got to be accountable to him, because there's only room for one church, and some sort of spiritual church is not real. You know, like, if your relationship with your spouse is only spiritual, you're missing out on a lot, right? And so the church is not just a spiritual thing. The church is a real thing in the world, and it means we have to be able to get along with one another and love our neighbors. And so that's why we have to figure out a way to be connected to the Vatican in some way if we're going to follow Jesus. Yeah.
Going back to Mary, if
that's the case, yeah, that this was God's plan in some way. So it's God that really organized the secret plan, the sneaky plan, and it's a similar plan that God organized when Tamar tripped Judah. I mean, you can see that it's really God is the sneaky one here that's flipping the system with these women, and now it's getting really flipped with Mary and with Jesus. So yeah, okay.
I was born and raised Catholic. I go to a Protestant church for the last 6 years. And this is my second time here. I've been more of a patient with them. So. But my church doesn't understand how I feel about this, about being a Catholic. And I like what you said, but I think everybody overthinks. I think we're overthinking it. We should just realize God picked Mary. Mary was Jesus. Mother, you can't get too much better than that. I mean, out of anybody in the Bible, if I could pick someone, I'm going to Jesus' mother. So I think we should, like you said, though, there's a big difference between worshiping and worshiping.
Yeah, Mary is the greatest model that we have in Scripture of what a Christian looks like. I mean, she... we talk about being born again. Well, she did it literally, you know? Like, and so that's where we need to focus on her at much greater levels, and we need to be careful of our fear of talking about Mary, because she's really the most interesting character here, I think. I saw another hand over here. Yeah.
Well, I was going to ask, why is the genome half Mary's? It could be both gods.
Yeah.
Or there was only 23 chromosomes instead of 46.
That's kind of my point there, Doc. That trying to count Jesus' chromosomes is a difficult thing, right? And so where did the other half come from? And was it a real half? And then, well, do we believe that Jesus is half God and half human? No, that's Hercules, right? Hercules is half God and half human. We're in the wrong myth. And what do we believe about Jesus?
Fully God,
that's 100%.
And 100% man.
And how much human? 100% human. And now we've got some real DNA challenges, right? But we've got something that helps us in theology. Yeah. Well, so I want us to think a little bit more about Joseph. What I love about his role is that he's not the star of the show. I mean, and that's why he's almost forgotten. You know, there are people in South America that worship Mary, right? But Joseph doesn't have a group of people that worship him. You know, he's left out of most of the postcards that you got at Christmas. You know, he's not real exciting. He's just old Joe. But I think that Joseph can help us a lot, because it's often our goal to kind of be the step parent. We got some good music going on. I have a stepfather who is a wonderful man who has helped me so much, that I love really dearly, and from him I have learned an awful lot. And so Joseph is the stepfather who is, you know, not given a lot of credit. Maybe doesn't get to walk anybody down the aisle. You know, he's in the periphery, and yet he's the one that gives Jesus the name. He's the one that allows the story to unfold. He could have pressed charges. He could have had her possibly killed, possibly stoned for this. And Joseph allows it to happen, and is the stepfather to Jesus. And I think that this role of stepfather is something for us to think about. Like, what if we thought of ourselves as stepmothers and stepfathers to what God is birthing in the world right now? Our role as church, I think, is to be like Joseph, and to figure out what God is doing in the world, to find Marys who are pregnant with God's purpose, and to find places where Jesus is showing up, and to help allow it to happen. We don't always get to play Jesus in the story, right? And maybe we don't always get to play Mary. I mean, That's the part that we'd like to play. But I think that often we have an opportunity to play Joseph. We can not stop what's happening. We can encourage it. We can make a safe place for it. And we can choose to see the disciples around us as people that we can shepherd and mentor, and we can parent outside of our own family. And I think that's what's really important about the ecclesia, the church, the community that Matthew's gospel is talking about, is that it's trying to raise up children and mentor new disciples. And so Joseph ends up being a great role model for developing church and developing that kind of community. What do you think about that? Huh?
Is the genealogy going through Joseph here in Matthew?
Well,
it looks like it is.
It is, yeah.
Instead of Mary.
Yeah, it is. It's interesting that Luke's gospel really attaches it to Mary. Because Luke's gospel wants to make sure that we realize that Jesus is, remember I told you before, that genealogy means Jesus is the Son of God. So Joseph is just like forgotten in, almost entirely in Luke's gospel. You got very little Joseph story. But Matthew's purpose is very different. And he gives us the genealogy through Joseph. Yeah. The last thing that... No, that's enough, actually, for this material. We're going to look at the Moses typology and the flight to Egypt next week. And then I want you to go ahead and pick up with the flight to Egypt and the rest of that chapter. And we'll kind of close talking about We Three Kings. You know, that song is not very good as far as the Bible goes, right? Because we don't know that there are three of them. Why does tradition say there are three of them?
Because there are three gifts.
Three gifts. So we got three gifts in the story. But for all we know, they could have been given by the same dude. Right? So we don't know that there are three of them. And then kings. What about that? They are not kings. Yeah, they are magi. They are magi, which we get the word magician from it. And in kind of Persian-y sort of language, it means... the pagan priest. So the magi are pagan priests, and they come from Parthia,
Iran
area. They're pagan priests. They're outside of the family of faith, and yet the inside of the family of faith, well, they miss it, right? And then these Wiccan people then these Muslims come in, or you could call it whatever you want in our story, but these outsiders that we've been fighting against, well, all of a sudden, their priests get it. And they come, and they offer gifts. I mean, this really cuts against what we want to believe. I mean, we want to believe that the story about three kings, that's a lot easier, right? A story about three kings that come, you know, they're rich and powerful, and you know, they're like us, or they're like we want to be, right? And they get it. But what about pagan priests getting it? Astrologers.
Was that also the movement of the early 1800s? I mean, when they kind of started putting all the gilt and gold and everything on the story?
Yeah. Well, the kings of Europe really were interested in these being kings,
yeah.
Right? they liked the whole idea of the kings getting it right. You know, you can see how power plays into the narrative. But they're Gentiles. That's really important. They're not Jewish, and they come. And so, what do you think? Matthew's gospel is the only one that records a story, right? Luke doesn't need it.
So this.
Nobody else needs it. So why is Matthew telling us this story? Because he could have left it out like everybody else. He's telling it to the community, a Jewish community that's too tight, right? And he's saying, "All right, it's time to open up. It's time to open up. This is a fundamental flaw with our society, with our community. We have got to be open to these outsiders. Look at how they were a part of the story in the beginning. Not only are they outsiders." But they were of a completely different religion with different gods, and yet they were able to get enough of it. And so I think it helps us as church when we when we worry about outsiders as well, yeah.
It wasn't even in that same time frame, was it?
Well, so that's another part, you know, when the nativity scene, they're all there at the same time, but from the narrative here, we get the idea that Jesus was about two. And so, now, was Jesus exactly two? They killed the two-year-old infants, right? But that story, now we're moving ahead to next week, is really going through the Moses typology again, right? We've heard that story before in the book of Moses. So, so we're gonna come back to that next time. But I guess as our closing thought and prayer, it's about how we can welcome other people into our church, into our family, people that aren't like us. God has a desire to bless the world, bless all the nations through the church. And yet the church, everywhere it is, tries to lock its doors and to be homogeneous. And this story is a radical story about inclusion and about how the outsiders often have it more right than we do on the inside. I think that's right, and that's where Matthew's gospel is a great bridge from the Old Testament to the New. I mean, when it ties in, you keep that Jewishness flavor, and you keep the Moses story going, and you got the genealogy that carries it through, and so it's a wonderful tie-in. So we're going to close with a prayer, thinking about Magi in our lives, and powerful women, and how to welcome Christ into the world. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks as we begin this journey on the book of Matthew. This is our story. It's the story of your Son, and it has become good news for the world. Help it be good news for us as we study. Help us to have our eyes open to see the sneaky way that you are working in the world, overturning structures of power, upsetting the status quo, bringing down the powerful and lifting up the lowly. Open our eyes this week that we may see Magi in the world, people who are outside of our church, outside our community, yet need to be welcomed in. We give you thanks for the way that you welcomed us when we were outside, and we give you thanks for the powerful women in our lives, our mothers, our grandmothers, the matriarchs of Israel. We give you thanks for Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, Bathsheba, and most of all Mary, for the way that you've used them as instruments. Use us as well. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.